In this video, I'm going to cover the main features you can use to differentiate chronic inflammation from acute inflammation. These are primarily the causes and morphologic features of acute inflammation. We'll look at some of the cells and mediators involved in the process, and then end by taking a closer look at granulomatous inflammation. In contrast to acute inflammation, which can last days to weeks, chronic inflammation develops and exists over a longer time frame, often weeks to months or even years. During this time, inflammation, tissue injury, and attempts to repair coexist in varying combinations. And if you recall from the acute inflammation videos, inflammation and tissue injury both occur in acute inflammation, but in that scenario, the length of time these exist over is much shorter, and the progression to chronic inflammation typically occurs when there is an inability to eliminate the inflammatory stimulus or completely heal the tissue damage. Stimuli that cannot be eliminated can be things like persistent infections. Certain microorganisms are difficult to eradicate, and these can cause a delayed hypersensitivity reaction, or sometimes cause a granulomatous reaction. Hypersensitivity diseases include excessive and inappropriate activation of the immune system through things like allergic and autoimmune reactions. These are repetitive reactions against antigens normally present in the environment or in the body. And then prolonged exposure to toxic agents can also be a cause. These are exogenous or endogenous substances and are things like asbestos fibers, silica dust, or atherosclerotic plaques. Now, the features of this type of inflammation are firstly mononuclear infiltrate. This is more of a histological feature, but predominantly there are going to be macrophages as well as lymphocytes and plasma cells in the tissue. There's also going to be tissue destruction, either from the inflammatory stimulus itself or from the inflammatory cells. There will also be concurrent attempts at healing by replacing damaged cells with connective tissue, which is most commonly blood vessels and fibrous tissue. Good examples of this side-by-side destruction and healing process is actually seen in liver cirrhosis, in which there is normal or regenerating liver tissue surrounded by bands of scar tissue. Mononuclear infiltrate are cells like macrophages, lymphocytes, and plasma cells. Macrophages are the dominant cells in most chronic inflammatory reactions, and like neutrophils, these ingest and eliminate microbes and dead tissues. While they're located in systemic circulation, they are called monocytes, and they have a relatively short half-life, about a day long. But once they leave systemic circulation and enter tissues, they become macrophages and have a much longer half-life, lasting for weeks, months, or even years. In some specific tissues, like the liver or the brain, they have special names like Kupffer cells or microglia. Macrophages begin to move from circulation into tissues after inflammatory stimulus begins and become the dominant cell type after about 48 hours. And in addition to destroying foreign invaders or tissues, these cells also secrete cytokines and growth factors and can activate other cells like T lymphocytes. And I'm going to briefly mention that macrophages themselves can become activated through two different pathways, which are the classical and alternative pathways. First off is the classical pathway. This produces macrophages that have an enhanced ability to kill ingested organisms, as well as secrete cytokines to further stimulate inflammation. And it is these macrophages that are responsible for injuring normal tissues. In contrast, the alternative pathway produces macrophages that are not actively microbicidal, and the cytokines that activate these may also inhibit the classical pathway. The main function of these macrophages is tissue repair, and this is accomplished through the secretion of growth factors to promote angiogenesis, activation of fibroblasts, and they also stimulate collagen synthesis. These are all important processes for healing and are all features of chronic inflammation. Now, it would make sense that in response to most injurious stimuli, the first activation pathway, the classical one, which is designed to destroy the offending agent, would occur first and then be followed by the alternative pathway to initiate tissue repair. However, this precise sequence is not well documented in most inflammatory reactions, and it is more likely that both of these are occurring simultaneously. Lymphocytes also have a role to play. Microbes and other environmental antigens can activate both B and T lymphocytes, which can amplify and propagate chronic inflammation. Some of the strongest chronic inflammatory reactions, like granulomatous inflammation, which we'll touch on in a following slide, are actually dependent on lymphocyte responses due to their ability to secrete cytokines. CD4 positive lymphocytes, or the helper T cells, promote inflammation and influence the nature of the inflammatory reaction. Activated B lymphocytes and the antibody-producing plasma cells are often present at sites of chronic inflammation. These antibodies may be specific for foreign antigens or self-antigens in the inflammatory site or against altered tissue components. But the specificity and even the importance of antibodies in most chronic inflammatory disorders are unclear. These other cell types may be present in certain forms of chronic inflammation when particular stimuli are present. Eosinophils, for example, are commonly seen in parasitic infections because they have granules containing major basic protein, which is toxic to parasites. This protein can also cause lysis of mammalian epithelial cells, so these are good at controlling parasites, but also contribute to tissue damage and immune reactions. Mast cells participate in both acute and chronic inflammatory reactions by releasing histamine and prostaglandins. These are most often seen in response to type 1 immediate hypersensitivity reactions, more commonly referred to as allergic reactions, typically in response to food, insect venom, or drugs. Even though these reactions are often immediate and acute, these mast cells are also present in chronic inflammation, and because they secrete cytokines, they can continue to stimulate chronic inflammation. And lastly, neutrophils, while characteristic of acute inflammation, many forms of chronic inflammation continue to show large numbers of neutrophils. These may be present due to persistent microbes or by mediators produced by activated macrophages and T lymphocytes. Granulomatous inflammation is a form of chronic inflammation which is characterized by collections of activated macrophages, often with T lymphocytes and sometimes associated with central necrosis. This is the body's attempt to contain an offending agent that is difficult to eradicate. There is often strong T cell activation, leading to macrophage activation, which can cause injury to normal tissues, and these are the classically activated macrophages. These activated macrophages can develop abundant cytoplasm and begin to resemble epithelial cells. When this occurs, these are called epithelioid cells. Some macrophages may also fuse to become multinucleated giant cells. There are two types of granulomas, the foreign body and the immune granuloma. The foreign body can be caused by inert foreign bodies in the absence of T-cell mediated immune response. These are commonly seen around things like talc from IV drug abuse, sutures, or other fibers that are large enough to not be phagocytosed, and these do not elicit any specific inflammatory immune response. The foreign material is often identified in the center of the granuloma and is exemplified by the picture on the left, in which gauze was surgically removed after a previous surgery and a granuloma formed around that piece of gauze. Immune granulomas, on the other hand, can be caused by agents which are capable of inducing a persistent T-cell mediated immune response. These granulomas form when inciting agents are difficult to eradicate, such as a persistent microbe or self-antigen. In granulomas associated with tuberculosis, which is the prototype of granulomatous disease caused by an infection, there is an area of hypoxia and free radical mediated injury, which leads to a central zone of necrosis. This causes a cheesy granular appearance, which is referred to as caseous necrosis. And when a granuloma is identified, tuberculosis should always be excluded as the cause before moving on to other differentials. Other granulomas seen in Crohn's, sarcoidosis, or foreign body reactions tend not to have this necrotic center and are said to be non-caseating.